Okay, joining us now is the CEO of SumZero, a company dedicated to investment professionals, Divya Narendra, also one of the co-founders of Facebook. Welcome. We're so happy to have you.
Joe DiMatteo. Do you know who Joe DiMatteo is? DiMatteo Moness.
From Moness Crespi?
Yeah, well, he's not Moness Crespi. Billy Moness is Annie Moness's son.
Okay.
Annie Moness founded Moness Crespi and Hart. Okay, so Joe, I didn't even know that the SumZero thing was your thing, okay?
Okay.
I'm having drinks with Joe DiMatteo, I don't know, 7 months ago, and he started talking about SumZero, and then I went to the site, but it's like locked out, like I can't get into it.
It's a little locked out, yeah.
Right, so what, so it's,
maybe
it's,
for
it's,
a reason.
I'm going to say what it is, and then you're going to tell me how I got
sure.
it wrong. It's like hedge funders go on to exchange long-short ideas like they used to do at idea dinners, where in the 80s they would get together at like Mr. Chow over orange chicken and swap long-short ideas. Is that accurate?
People still do that.
That's part of the business, and that's the sort of founding concept behind SumZero, which was to create this community for professional investors on the buy side to share research. So these are typically, you know, multi-thousand word reports covering stocks and sometimes bonds and other asset classes. And then what we started, you know, realizing was that our users could leverage that research for other purposes that are more career related, so finding jobs at funds or at raising capital as well. So we now have over 400 LPs on SumZero that look at the research to determine which managers are good based upon what they're posting, and those conversations can lead to a manager raising capital down the road. And from a recruiting standpoint, because when people post, we track returns and other users can rate ideas,
yes.
You can really see how an analyst performs, and maybe you interview that analyst for a job or whatnot. So
well, Marshall Fields does this. You know Marshall Fields?
I think you're talking about Marshall Waste.
Marshall Waste, which is a hedge fund that used to make brokers submit ideas and would allocate commissions based on how good the ideas
were. Yeah, exactly. So there's a lot you can do with just high-quality content and combining that with the data that comes with the fact that these things trade in the markets and you can calculate returns and... you know, I think this site has sort of taken on its very interesting role in that it's easily the largest repository of buy-side research available anywhere. So we're directly competing with Wall Street research from the sell side, as well as traditional independent research providers like Morningstar, Off Wall Street, those kinds of firms.
So it is a professional network for people who work at hedge funds, private equity firms,
mutual funds, yeah.
Yes, as well. And I think probably the natural question for a viewer is, well, there's such a layer of secrecy oftentimes built around, you know, some of these investment theses. So
yeah.
Why would someone share that? Why would someone be able to share that on a platform like yours?
There is and there isn't. What happens normally is that once an analyst builds a position in a company, once they have a full position, then they want to tell the world, hey, here's why I think Chipotle is a great short, or here's why I think Apple is undervalued, or here's why I think some obscure TMT company in Europe needs to be looked at, and they'll provide a target price once they have that full position. And obviously, if enough people look at that research and they agree with that author's view, it could move the price. And we've seen that happen on numerous occasions on the site, especially with companies that aren't the Apples in terms of market capitalizations, and some of the smaller cap names. Even some of the mid-cap names will actually move depending upon how many people act on that thesis. It's very interesting to see how the data correlates with.
Can you get the top tier hedge funds in there? Can you get SEC analysts, Lone Pine analysts, stuff like that?
Here's what we've seen is that the bigger funds, when you say top, I think you're really referring to the largest. Those firms.
Largest and the top. I mean, that's part of the issue.
There's a lot of debate about returns
best performing versus
just pure AUM. But what we found is that a lot of those bigger funds, for a variety of reasons, sometimes don't share research on the platform, but they have the option to buy access to other people's research on the platform. So there's kind of a pay or post model where you can either post research and get free access, or if you don't want to post your own ideas, you can just pay for access through a subscription.
I asked my question about secrecy because I know at some of the largest hedge funds in New York City that analysts cannot even put on a LinkedIn page which firm they work for. It just says analyst at a New York-based hedge fund.
Yeah.
So what you're saying makes sense. Talk to us, too, about if you have any comments on that, but also the give-and-take model, it sounds like, in order to access some of the perks maybe that go along with it, you do need to put research
forward. Before we were able to establish any sort of subscription model, we needed content. I'm sure I mean, a lot of companies face this hurdle. And so in the beginning, having a free, a free
Peter, show him.
Method in which you can get access to research was really important. And so we spent a lot of our early days just building community, building engagement, trying to figure out, okay, what are all the levers that we can pull to compel people to share proprietary content? And, we found that those smaller emerging managers were more receptive to using social media. But I think today you sort of see this, with mainstream media, where, a lot of the larger PMs at bigger funds will also use the media to disseminate their views.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so will you give me access to this or no?
We can talk about it.
Well, I'm an LP and my brother-in-law's hedge fund. So I'm going to talk.
You should join as an allocator.
Fizzell should. David Fizzell is my brother-in-law. His fund is Honeycomb. He actually just announced his fund. Do you know him or no?
I don't know him, but okay. That doesn't mean anything.
Anyway, he's running a couple hundred million sticks now.
He's the perfect guy for this thing.
So yeah, he'd be good for this, but he'll
having
say
access
no.
to M0 is like having
no to everything.
It's like having a whole new analyst team that's an extension of your own analyst team. To get more research more quickly, to get up to speed on names more quickly, to get the contrarian view on a company that you might like a lot. So if you're short Tesla, somebody might be long Tesla, you can see what's that guy's, how did he come to that conclusion? And then just the diversity of content, because we have members from all over the globe. So, whether you like, U.S. like large cap equities, or you like Asian Chinese e-commerce, or what, there's going to be research on that on the site. So it's that breadth of coverage combined with the quality of the content, the rigor of the analysis that I think is so unique.
How many people are on it?
Thing.
Okay, yeah, that's good. But how many people are on
it's
it?
It's around 13,000 members, mostly concentrated in the major financial markets. The actual number of funds that spans is in the thousands. It's hard to have
an
exact number, but
it's a
lot.
Yeah. The point.
All right, so now we do the sponsored segment with SoFi. Okay, do you know SoFi?
I know the basics.
Okay, good. Yeah. And so we're going to ask you some questions on leadership and kind of how you sort of made it in life. So so walk us through your education, what you studied when you were a kid, what you studied in college, how you financed it, how you made that whole thing come about.
What did I study in college? Well, I went to Harvard College undergrad. I was class of 2004. I was an applied math major, which at Harvard doesn't really mean anything. You sort of take a very interdisciplinary approach to math, it's sort of, there's some pure math in there, there's some like more applied stuff, physics, computer science, etc. I did take some CS when I was a student. I didn't have a clear sense of what I wanted to do until I discovered entrepreneurship. And so this whole Facebook saga that I got involved with was my first sort of brush with entrepreneurship. And I think I realized at the time that, for a guy like me, I sort of always felt like I was more of a jack of all trades generalist than somebody who was really good at any one thing, that entrepreneurship really like resonated with my personality. And so even though it didn't work out as planned, I kind of knew in the back of my head that it'd be something down the road I'd want to do. As far as how, you asked how I started it or whatever, there's the idea phase, and I think that's kind of, you have to spend some time thinking. I think people often, when they get really busy, they get caught up in sort of what they're doing, and sometimes they don't take the time to reflect about what they see around them. And what I saw in college was a lot of students who wanted to connect but couldn't, or there were certain barriers in place that an online solution would have been a very simple, sort of obvious thing to create. And so I went down that path, started forming a team. Regarding like the financing aspect of it, at that time I was 19 and didn't really have any money, so it was very bootstrap slash, I called my parents to be like, hey, can I get some cash to...
Do you take loans to go to college?
I did not, so I was lucky in that my parents kind of hooked that up. Loans really throw a kink in, I think, the entrepreneurial process, because what happens is, people, I think the mentality is, okay, if I have a big loan, first I have to get a job, and then once I pay them off, I go do my own thing. And that, I think for a lot of people that can cause a bit of a delay but at the same time, there's so much capital available today where if you really want to start a business, even if you are coming from a, you have debt outstanding, like you can, with the right idea and the right founding team, it's you know, the opportunities are there. So there's so many people looking to deploy capital, and you know, I think this is as great a time as any.
Our last question for the segment: how do you define success?
I guess we talked about this before. I don't see success as like a one moment in time sort of thing. I sort of see it as this long journey, oftentimes characterized by a lot of little victories that over time add up. And I think, as long as, especially for entrepreneurs, as long as you have persistence, which is probably the one characteristic that serves as a common denominator across all entrepreneurs,
Yeah. You're
going to do well. I don't think it's an intelligence thing. I think you guys interview so many folks. You probably meet some people who you're like,
700.
Man, how in the world did this person like get so successful? But, you know, I think a lot of it has to do with persistence. I think there is
Grit. Have you read this book, Grit?
No.
It's unbelievable. I mean, she's like a major professor, researcher.
Yeah.
Her philosophy is the grit and perseverance is 2x more correlated to success than raw IQ.
I would completely agree. I know so many smart people who are way smarter than I am who you would argue are not maybe meeting their potential. And like, I think that's kind of the main reason is they can, sometimes it's focus. This is what I also see is a lot of entrepreneurs, or I get asked this question like, oh, you're doing some zero. What else are you doing? You know, and I'm always surprised by that question because I'm not doing anything else, you know, like it's sort of a full-time job. And I think you have to have that sort of singular, I have this idea, I believe in this idea. And obviously it takes a lot of research of your own to convince yourself that the idea is worth pursuing. But once you've kind of concluded that it's worth pursuing, you kind of have to focus on it and just go for it. And I think that sometimes it's hard to teach that, but I think that's one of the key defining traits of any good entrepreneur.
But before we let you go, I'm going to ask you a Facebook question.
And sure.
I don't feel like a jerk asking you this because I did BuzzFeed for 4 years and I left and people ask me about BuzzFeed all the time. And I don't want to ask you a stupid question either. So my interesting question is, how often do you think about it? Okay, and when you do think about it, I mean, I'm at a point now where when I think about BuzzFeed, it's always like, what were the management lessons I learned? What do I want to do the same? What do I want to do differently? How is the company in your mind now? How do you think about it now on a day-to-day basis?
I think Facebook's a great case study for all entrepreneurs. Because it's a network effects business. It was once a dorm room startup. So, I mean, you can sort of track, how did they get from zero to $350 billion market cap? It's just a very interesting case study. And a lot of what they're working on is relevant to what a lot of startups are working on, which is community engagement, content, just getting people to interact and to log in and to not just log in, but use the platform and connect with folks. So it's not like we think about Facebook every day, but sometimes when we're thinking about building a feature, for example, SumZero has a newsfeed on it. Now, it's not a newsfeed that's exactly like, say, a Facebook or a LinkedIn, but there's certain elements of it that are thematically similar. And it comes down to, how do you deliver content to people that's relevant to them, right?
Uh-huh.
That's kind of a fundamental question that I think where you can use Facebook as a case study, but you can also use things like LinkedIn and other players in the space that have done well. So we do look at, the best of breed businesses that relate to what we do, if not directly, at least tangentially or indirectly. And it's, I think, very helpful because they've sort of charted a path. And the other thing that's interesting is that these larger companies, because they have such enormous scale and there's so many users that are on the platform, from a UI standpoint, they're used to things being in certain places.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you're a startup and you're trying to build a new interface, you don't have to reinvent the wheel, right? You can sort of leverage some of the some of that UI that people are already used to when building a new feature. So we do kind of, I think, take advantage of some of that precedent that exists.
Yes. Very good. Well, this is a wonderful segment.
This is wonderful. And I'm going to email you about the SumZero access, and then you can tell me offline, no, I'm not giving it you, John, so you don't have to embarrass me.
We'll show you the site, you'll have fun with it, especially if you do any of your own, like, PA.
I'm an LP.
Yeah.
I'm an LP in a fund, so I guess I qualify.
Yeah.
All right.
Sounds good. Thank you, David.
Thanks a lot, man. Stay
right
there. Thanks, you guys.
Coming up.